I'm not the Gnul either, as young or as beautiful, but I was fortunate. She called me this morning and had a conflict, and so I'm happy. I'm delighted, actually, to be here. I'm Deborah Jones, the scholar in residence at the MEI right now, and also a former consul general in Istanbul, and have a special affection for Turkey and all things Turkish, and continue to watch very closely, as I think we all do here. The Middle East Institute Center for Turkish Studies and the Institute of Turkish Studies at Georgetown University are proud to present what is our sixth discussion in a joint lecture series featuring today Professor Murat Somer of Koç University in Istanbul. Professor Somer is an associate professor of international relations who specializes in comparative politics, political economy, and Turkish politics, which in and of itself is enough to keep one occupied, I think, for two lives, not one. He writes on ethnic conflicts and nationalism, democratization, religious and secular politics, the Kurdish question, and political Islam. And in his spare time, I don't know what he does, if he has spare time. Currently, he's working on two books, one on the Kurdish question and the other on the relationship between Muslim and secular elite values and democracy. And today, Professor Somer is going to examine how countries with semi-democratic or authoritarian centers, such as Turkey, or many of the Arab Awakening or Arab Spring polities, must rely on cooperation between religious and secular actors to achieve greater democratization. He's also, I think, going to discuss how modernization in Turkey and other Muslim countries has resulted in some very profound cleavages between religious and secular elites. And so it's my pleasure now to turn the time over to Professor Murat Somer. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador, for this introduction, and thank you all for coming here today. I hope you can see the screen. So what I want to talk about today is being a comparative political scientist, but also specializing in Turkish politics, reflect on what we learn from the Turkish experience of democratization, as far as other Muslim countries, and in particular Middle Eastern countries are concerned. What can we learn from the Turkish case? How can we model it? How can we conceptualize it? This is, of course, important because the current context in the Middle East, we observe that what we can call moderate Islamist actors are in power, have come to power in places like Egypt, Turkey, and also the Justice and Development Party in Turkey. Of course, what does it mean to be a moderate political Islamist that's the big question mark there, and I put it there, of course, deliberately. And one major goal in my talk, and also one of my major interests, is to conceptualize what it means to be a moderate, and what does it mean, what does moderation mean in academia as well as in policy debates. We use this concept very frequently. Democracy is supposed to be a product of cooperation between moderate actors, but who are the moderate actors and how can we conceptualize moderation? And you know, this is the Turkish case, I think, helps a lot to conceptualize this, this concept. And if you're thinking of how we use this concept, I think we can perhaps question our usage of this term very much. We often associate being moderate with being democratic as well. Whenever you read a newspaper article, you know, we write one, then we talk about moderates, and when we talk about moderates, we talk about Democrats, right? Moderates are the ones, the actors in any country that that deserve to be supported. by external actors as well who desire democratization and who want to support democratization in countries, in developing countries. So, and this is actually a recent article I provided more detailed discussion of this in a recent article of mine, and I basically make two major arguments. One is moderation is often used in the context of an expectation from political Islam. It's used as a concept to explain a transformation that the political Islamist actors are supposed to experience. But moderation should not be expected from Islamists alone in any country, because it is an interactive process. Moderation, the way I conceptualize it, is not an ideological or behavioral transformation that any single actor experiences, but it is an interactive process between religious and secular political actors. This can be applied to other cases, say Latin America, where perhaps social class is a major cleavage, of course. Then we can talk about an interactive process between perhaps left and right political actors that represent different social classes. But in many Muslim countries, the cleavage between secular and Muslim political actors is a major cleavage. So then in my presentation, I will focus on this cleavage. It is an interactive process between religious and secular actors. And moderation, what is moderation? Moderation is always used as a compromise or adjustment to something. But more often than not, I mean, in fact, you know, just typically, we never explain or specify with what a moderating actor compromises or to what a moderating actor adjusts. Is this median waters? Is this a universal concept of democracy and human rights? What is it? And this is, I think, a major problem for us, because this is why many people also argue that, well, moderation is a very slippery concept. Because it's often, it looks very nice on paper, but in practice, when you approach any specific case and you need to identify who are the good guys, who are the bad guys, who are the moderates, who are the radicals, it often proves to be very difficult to identify them. It proves to be a very slippery concept. And at the end, moderates are identified as those, as one scholar has argued, the ones who don't want to rock the boat in practice. But I think, you know, this is a problem for us. And so I argue that, first of all, the values, the interests, and norms of behavior that comprise the centers in a country, they vary widely across countries. So I define moderation as an adjustment to the center in a specific country, and the center is different in every country. And therefore, the moderate actors will look very differently in different countries. So what does this say? What is the implication for democratization? How does this help us to better understand what democratization is? So I make a major distinction between countries that we can argue to have a democratic center, and democracy is not a black and white concept. Even a country with a democratic center may still need democratization. Think of the United States before the Civil Rights Movement. Since the second half of the 19th century, United States is considered to be a democracy. In democracy indices, it has the perfect score since the second half of the 19th century. It has a very democratic, liberal democratic constitution. So we can argue that it had already a democratic center in the 1950s, 1960s. But these norms, the laws, norms, of this center were not applied equally to everybody, of course. We know that racial groups, minorities, they were not benefiting equally from these rights and freedoms. And we all know that then with the civil rights movement, arguably we can say that the United States became more democratic with disenfranchised groups beginning to benefit from these rights and freedoms that are part of a democratic center. And today, who can argue that this country cannot become more democratic? There are many groups that are not they're disenfranchised, or they are not equally benefiting from rights and freedoms. So we have to define democratization as a process where more and more people, more and more regions, right? You know, it is also possible that sometimes, you know, the certain regions of a country may be very democratic, but certain regions are not really taking part in this democracy. So more and more people, more and more groups and regions benefiting from the rights and freedoms of a democracy, democracy expanding to more and more people. So even in a country with a democratic center, you may have democratization. Now, in countries that we can argue to have a democratic center, then we can say that moderates are Democrats, and moderation will help democratization. But we have to make a distinction between those cases and other cases where a country has a semi-democratic or authoritarian center. What if a country has a semi-democratic center or an authoritarian center? In this case, we cannot automatically claim that moderates will necessarily be Democrats, and their moderation will necessarily and automatically contribute to democratization. If a country has an undemocratic center, I argue that moderation may involve adoption, retention, and reproduction of the center's undemocratic attributes, norms, values, and institutions. So this is basically my general argument. Now, how does the Turkish case help us to develop this argument? And how can we better interpret the Turkish case by using this framework, theoretical conceptual framework? Now, think of the, first of all, when many people, just looking back until the 1990s, you can go to the New York Times, you can go to statements by international actors, the Western world perceive the seculars, social democrats, liberal, and so on, the secular actors to be the country's democrats. And of course, political Islamism was a threat, right? That was undemocratic, radical element. Well, we come to the 2000s. Well, moderate Islamists, or conservative democrats, as the Just and Development Party calls itself, I'm using a general term here, they are seen as the Democrats. I think of 2007, it was a showdown between the military and the Just and Development Party in Turkey, and there was a polarization between the seculars and the religious. And now the moderate Islamists are shown as the Democrats. But neither view is correct, I think. Because Muslim and secular democratic values can only be evaluated comparatively. How can one argue that a certain political actor has democratic values, democratic aspirations, without comparing to anything? We can only make sense of this comparatively. And this comparison should be made with respect to the political rivals, as well as to the country's center. So we need to first conceptualize what is the center in Turkey, and then we can decide who are the Democrats, who are not the Democrats. All right, let's think of the Turkish case. I'm sure everybody in this room is, some of us, much more than the others perhaps, but we all have some basic idea about the Turkish case. some of us are, I'm sure, in the room, they are experts. Let's think of the beginning, the foundational period of the Turkish case. The Turkish Republic was founded in 1923. At that time, two major types of actors in the country as well: Muslim conservatives, Islamists of that period, and the Kemalists, the secular nationalists. Now, under peculiar conditions, historical conditions, I will not go into the detail, the Kemalists in Turkey became a hegemonic actor. They were able to marginalize after the end of the War of Independence. They were able to sideline the Muslim conservative actors, and they were able to unilaterally shape the basic institutions and reshape of the basic institutions of the country. And this is the period I would call is that the emergence of a secularist political center in Turkey. We can talk about radical secularism. There were path-breaking reforms at that time. Top-down secularization that took place in Turkey. The caliphate was abolished. At that time, the legal system was half based on a modernized version of Sharia and half secular laws. The legal system was completely secularized. Women got more or less equal formal political and civic rights. The alphabet was changed. Even the outfit was changed, as many of us know. So this is a period of top-down secularization under the authoritarian single-party regime of the Republican People's Party, founded by Kemal Atatürk. And the secularism, the secular model, the laicist model that emerged at the time in Turkey is also an authoritarian model. I think it has two aspirations. One is to reform Islam, to reshape Islam in Turkey in a more rational, rational secular religion. And second, also to minimize the public role of religion. And this is accomplished with state involvement in religious affairs. It is not a case of strict separation of religion and state per se, but it is more about the state control of religion with the view to reform religion in the eyes of the state, but also the separate state from religion rather than the other way around. Okay, so of course it would take maybe 10 other lectures to discuss actually what are the consequences of this period, but maybe in a very summarized way, the positive implication, we can argue that, first of all, at that time Turkey developed an overarching national identity and state institutions, which many developing countries failed to accomplish. It's a major challenge for any new nation state. At that time, Turkey, I think we can argue that quite strong overarching national identity. And many scholars have argued that it contributed to the level of political, economic, and cultural developments it has reached today. But there is also a deficit side. One deficit side is a disgruntled group of Muslim conservative modernizers. They were silent. They did not want the caliphate to be abolished. They were not always against secularization or modernization, but they were against any. They were against many specific reforms that the Kemalists implemented at that time. They wanted a much more moderate and more religious conservative type of modernization. And of course, they were not happy that they were sidelined, that they did not have any say in the construction of this new state. And this led to, I would argue, that one of the deeper cleavages that typically emerged in Muslim countries between secular nationalists and Islamist elites. They both had a vision for modernization. westernization, modernization came to Muslim countries from outside. They had to deal with it in order to be able to compete with Western powers. The same for the Ottoman state, when they realized that they had to adapt to the new international environment and to become to achieve equality with Western states, they also embarked on modernization. But there was two very different visions of modernization. One was based on modernist Islamism, using Islam to modernize and to argue that, in fact, many of these modern concepts, such as constitutionalism, is compatible with Islam, and it has to be an Islamic version of modernization, versus the vision of the secular nationalists, who wanted a more comprehensive modernization and westernization. Now, this, I think, cleavage is visible in all countries, but in Turkey, I think this cleavage, I can reasonably argue that it's one of the deeper cleavages. I don't have a comparison, this is very difficult to compare, but I would say that it's one of the deeper cleavages in the Turkish case because of the this foundational period when the secular elites were able to reconstruct the basic institutions of Turkey. I think Turkey would not be very different from many Middle Eastern countries, however, if we had not seen also the moderation of the secular actors during the 1940s and 1950s. So the foundational period, of course, is not democracy. It's a single party, there's no free public society. It's an authoritarian period, top-down modernization, top-down secularization. But something I think quite remarkable happened in Turkey when the secular actors moderated. First by allowing the transition to electoral multi-party democracy. Now this is always easier said than done. Okay, many countries have tried to do this. But the seculars also accepted the results of the election in 1950 and relinquished power. So the power rotated as a result of more or less free and fair elections in 1950 in Turkey. So this is one major accepting competition, political competition. And second, the moderation of secular practices. To give just one example, the call to prayer was vernacularized during the 1930s. It was changed from Arabic to Turkish. Now it was changed back 1951 from Turkish to Arabic. Many shrines and tombs that were closed during the 1930s, they were reopened. Religious education was minimized before it restarted. So we see this moderation of secular practices. So this shows actually the willingness to compromise with the median voters in Turkey, because this was still a quite conservative society, religious conservative society, and when you transition to multi-party democracy, you need to get their votes. So they moderated some of these secular practices in order to appeal to the conservative median voters in Turkey. And also this reflected a compromise with the post-Second World War international context. Turkey was threatened by the Soviet Union and decided to join the Western camp. And the Western camp upheld electoral democracy, at least not necessarily liberal democracy, but democracy is the norm. And this was another incentive for the secular actors to moderate. But these changes, however, were never institutionalized through explicit formal compromises between Muslim and secular actors to produce a fully democratic center. It's not that the Republican People's Party and the opposition, first opposition, and then the ruling Democrat Party, which reflected, represented the more center-right, conservative, religious segment of society, they never sit down and reach some kind of a compromise in terms of laws, constitution. They never really compromise their conflicting visions of modernization. The conflicts between these two visions really remained in place. And I think these two visions are potentially mutually exclusive in many ways. I'm not saying that they cannot be reconciled, but it is not an easy job to do. So it happened more to political clientelism. When the Democrat Party came to power, gradually really allowed more religious education, with recruitment practices, allowed more conservative segments of society to be employed in the state, opened more religious high schools, built more mosques, and things like that. This is based on political clientelism, but never a compromise that we expect from two moderate actors to sit down and reconstruct a new center in terms of its laws, in terms of its norms, principles, and so on. And no ideological compromise. All right, so I will skip many periods, of course, we don't have, in the interest of time. I just want to show you that, so I talked about secular moderation at the time, and we experienced during the 1990s the moderation of political Islamism in Turkey. Political Islamism in Turkey, the explicit political Islamism in Turkey, became part of the picture in 1969, basically during the 1970s, with the first establishment of explicit political Islamist parties. And these parties, and the Milli Görüş movement, the National Outlook movement, established many parties. These parties became part of minor partners in coalition governments during the 1970s. And during the 1990s, we see a major transformation of this movement and the establishment of the Justice and Development Party, which is the present ruling party in Turkey. So their moderation was quite different from the secular moderation, because at that time, the center in Turkey had also changed quite significantly. We are talking about a different country, a different center, so therefore their moderation looks very different as well. So, the major elements of the moderation of the political Islamist actors in Turkey was one, first of all, the suppression of religious and Islamist discourse. Actually, I compared the party programs, and in other ways, you can show very clearly, you know, how, in fact, the use of religion and religious terms and religious concepts really diminished during this period. This was, of course, a compromise with the secularist institutions of the country, the Constitutional Court, and of course the military. These are secularist institutions in Turkey, and they previously had shut down political Islamist parties. In 1997, also forced the political Islamist party, welfare party at the time, to leave government. So they knew that very well. So the religious discourse was minimized to compromise with these secularist institutions. And in Turkish constitution, actually, the use of religion in politics is still illegal. Second, the adoption of the discourse of liberal democracy as opposed to majoritarian democracy. At that time, Turkey had already become, in 1999, an official candidate for EU membership. So the international component of the center became also strong and liberal democratic because of the EU. And Justice and Development Party embraced Western alliances, the EU, NATO, US, in contrast to by comparison, at least by comparison to previous political Islamist parties. And it very much embraced economic globalism and integration with the global markets. And it did so more effectively than any other competing party, including the secular parties. It embraced the EU membership more effectively and strongly than its secular political rivals, which had been the frontrunners of Turkey's EU aspirations previously. Okay, so what I want to do next is just briefly compare the religious and secular elite values in Turkey. Remember, at the beginning of my presentation, I talked about how we can identify Democrats in a country, you know, moderates, and I tried to argue that often this association between moderates and Democrats is misleading, and we cannot just focus on one actor, secular or religious, but we have to look at both, because it only makes sense if we, in a comparative context. So this is based on my ongoing research since several years now. I decided to measure elite values by through a content analysis of Islamic conservative and secular press in Turkey, because Turkey is a very activist press. The elites who write in the press are not just journalists who are reporting events, but they see themselves as part of the intelligentsia with a right and even a mission to shape political events and to inform as and sometimes lead society. So I thought this was a good platform. And it also enables us to have a very much larger sample. You know, often research is based on very narrow samples, which are not representative. But thanks to this methodology, I was able to look more than 40,000 articles. I was able to look at all the issues in this press. Not one columnist or one writer, but everybody who writes in these newspapers, and sometimes academics, politicians, civil society actors, and so on. And I get interviews, of course, with NGOs, Islamic and secular NGOs, and so on. I looked at many different subjects. I'm not going to talk, obviously, about all, nationalism, modernization, secularization, Western world, US, EU, things like that. I just want to provide you with a summary picture of how we can compare religious and secular actors in Turkey. I will give you just three types of findings. One is about democracy, obviously, political democracy. And here, and I can show you many more tables, we see a major transformation of the views in the religious press about democracy. Now, in the just comparing two periods, 1996 to 1999, with the period of 2001 to 2004. For example, positive views in the religious press about electoral democracy increased from 65% to 71%, and about liberal democracy from 69% to 76%. Now, I looked at three papers. One is representative of the old political Islamist movement in Turkey, the National Outlook Movement, Milli Gazete, for those of you who are familiar with it. So that is, of course, very much associated with the old quote-unquote Islamist movement. If we leave that out, if you compare the other two newspapers, then we see an even greater transformation. The positive views about electoral democracy increased from 66%. I think I can. There's no mouse here, but the second row from the bottom, 66% to 81%, and. The about liberal democracy from 76% to 87%. And the negative views, any criticisms of liberal democracy and electoral democracy also decreased in the same period. Oops. So at the end, so what is the summary result of this? The evaluation of liberal democracy in the secular press and the religious press became more or less very close to each other. The views of the religious elites converged on that of the secular elites. The positive views about liberal democracy was 71%. In the religious press, it was 73% in the secular press. So we see this then democratization in the views, or pro-democratic transformation in the views of the religious elites. In the case of social pluralism, however, we see a different picture. With respect to social pluralism, we observe that the religious elites are significantly much more skeptical of social pluralism than secular actors. So what does social pluralism mean? The coexistence of different ethnic, religious, social groups in society, the coexistence of different lifestyles, the coexistence of different ideologies. These are all part of the concept of social pluralism. And if you look at the overall evaluation of the religious elites of social pluralism, they remain much more conservative and skeptical of social pluralism than the secular actors. Just to give you a few examples, what does this mean? You know, there are many different shades of social pluralism. Of course, some are much more important in Turkey. For example, women's rights. And here, for example, one major problem of Turkish women that the political Islamist actors have focused on has been this headscarf issue in Turkey. The ban on headscarves in educational institutions as well as in government buildings for certain professions. And the political Islamists have really focused on this problem. But other than this aspect of women's issues in Turkey, we see very little discussion of these other issues among the religious elites. Turkish women have many other problems. First of all, only a quarter of Turkish women are part of the labor force. This is very low. They face other problems such as discrimination, domestic violence, and even killings. So there are many, many problems. So in this case, we would expect in any democratic, among any democratic group of elites, we would expect to, this is a major problem of democratization. So we should expect to see a discussion of it. So how can women's rights be improved? What can be done about it? But we see actually very little discussion within, for example, just the question of affirmative action or quotas in the parliament or in other representative institutions. Negative or positive, you may agree or disagree, but we would expect to see some discussion of it. There were only a total of 26 callings of this in a period of 9 years. So this is very low. And of course, the negative views are also quite significant. Another issue in Turkey and another problem of Turkish secularism is the unequal representation of Muslim minorities. Alevi Muslim minority is a major minority in Turkey, but they are not represented in Turkish religious institutions. They face discrimination because their shrines are not considered to be legitimate religious shrines in Turkey, cemevis. They are not considered as mosques or as legitimate religious institutions, so they do not get any government benefit that Sunni mosques are benefiting. So there is almost no discussion of this problem, actually, in the religious press either. Homosexuality, gender minorities, is very little discussion of it, and very negatively. Homosexuality is just described as a sickness and as a disease whenever it was discussed. But there is very little discussion of it anyway. Interesting subject is also nationalism. Well, Turkey is a nationalist society, quite nationalist. We see this in world value surveys, and we don't need to go to the surveys. It's a nationalist society. And often this nationalism, and every society is entitled to have its nationalism, of course. But if you think of the Turkey's problems of democratization, whether Kurdish issue or other ethnic minorities and so on, too much nationalism may, of course, make it more difficult to solve these problems. And do we see that maybe one actor, the religious or secular actor, is more nationalist than the other? If we just compare the religious and secular press, we see that the religious press is less religious, not very significantly, but the negative views of nationalism, negative consequences of nationalism, for example, is about 20% in the religious press and 9% in secular press. And the positive views are 50% in religious press and 61% in secular press. But if we compare the individual newspapers to each other, we don't see a clear distinction between separation between religious and secular newspapers. For example, Cumhuriyet, which is a secularist Republican newspaper in Turkey, is the most nationalist, but is immediately followed by Zaman. Zaman is a conservative newspaper, religious conservative newspaper associated with the powerful Gülen movement in Turkey, and is the next most nationalist newspaper, followed by the Milli Gazete, which is the, as I argued, the representative of the national outlook Islamism. And then followed by Yeni Şafak, which is a more liberal, conservative, liberal religious newspaper, which is also associated with the government, Justice and Development Party, or supportive of, has been very supportive of the Justice and Development Party. And finally, Milliyet, which is a moderate secular newspaper. So we don't see a separation between the religious and the secular here. So we, in fact, we see a reflection of the very fact that Turkey is a nationalist center. I can talk about the Kurdish issue if you want, because this is one of my major subjects of interest. I have also argued that we don't see here also that, for example, within the religious elites, we don't see sufficient discussion of the Kurdish issue. What does it take to resolve the Kurdish issue? We don't see sufficient discussion of it in the religious press. And this is quite puzzling because the government, in fact, tried to accomplish a major democratic opening with respect to this issue in 2008, but then it became it came to a halt later. And I think one of the reasons is that because there is not enough intellectual preparation which is necessary to know how, through which specific reforms, we can actually resolve the Kurdish conflict. Okay. One type of finding that I am not going to show today for you is also that with respect to secularism, there is also a major distinction between religious and secular press. This is a this shows this cleavage in Turkey. All right, so based on this, then I will argue that perhaps a kind of, I will give you several scenarios about how we can think about democratization in Turkey as well as other Muslim countries. And then I will finish. So I think, thinking based on all of these findings and reinterpreting the Turkish case, I think I developed these conclusions, and I think democratization can be conceptualized in terms of several scenarios. Scenario A is a case with a case of a country with a democratic center, and moderation takes place in this country with a democratic center. In this case, we can argue that democratization will follow, moderation will contribute to democratization, and the moderate actor will be a more democratic actor, and moderation will be sustained. But what happens if moderation takes place in the presence of an undemocratic or semi-democratic center, which is the case in Turkey? Turkey is a democracy, there is no question about that. It's an electoral democracy. Power rotates as a result of free and fair elections. But as international statistics also show, international organizations also show, it is not considered to be a fully free democracy, because there are major deficits of civic freedoms, freedoms of expression, freedoms of minorities, ethnic minorities, religious minorities, and so on. We still have an authoritarian state in Turkey, which does not sufficiently respect society and freedoms of individuals. So, if moderation takes place in the presence of an undemocratic or semi-democratic center, then we can imagine one scenario, scenario B1. A hegemonic moderate actor can build a more democratic center unilaterally. What does this mean? A powerful political party, such as the Justice and Development Party in Turkey, has been in power since 2002. In the last elections, got almost half of the votes in the national elections. Since 2007, it has also gained control of the military. So as a civilian government, it has a lot of power, electoral support, and also a lot of power vis-a-vis other state institutions. So a hegemonic, or you know, you can think of a liberal. I can give you more examples from Japan or other, but in terms of a country with a semi-democratic or authoritarian center, so a hegemonic moderate actor in this kind of a case, hypothetical case, can build a democratic center unilaterally. How? For example, it can make a new constitution. It can, with its policies, it can set the tone for the future, right? Resolve some major issues of democratization, enfranchise, disenfranchised groups, maybe help, you know, Turkish women to become more free, all kinds of things. And with this discourse, it can set the tone for a more democratic center. It can build new institutions that are more responsive to society, that are more respectful of opposition and things like that. If it has a very well-developed pluralist ideology, in other words, its values should be different from the existing center. It should transcend the existing center, and it has it must have developed a very democratic ideology. Or scenario B2, this moderate actor can build a more democratic center unilaterally if it has a very strong external support for democratization. This is also possible. And in Japan, under the hegemonic liberal Democrat party, democratized to a very significant extent thanks to the US support, right? External support and presence of the US. This is possible. Or the EU could play this role in Turkey.